Hello everybody. Welcome to this SMPTE Standards Update webcast. I want to welcome you and our guest speakers and everybody else. It's actually quite a good turnout for this time of the year. It's a lot of people on vacation and holidays. And so let's get right into this. I'm your host, Joel Welch, SMPTE's Director of Education. Appreciate you taking time out of your vacation or your work day to come join us. If this is your first time on a SMPTE Standards Update webcast, we try to do them quarterly. They're typically an hour long, try to make them as interactive as possible. These webcasts are a little different than our normal monthly educational webcasts. Those webcasts are a free member benefit, so SMPTE members get those and the on-demand webcasts free of charge. These webcasts, on the other hand, are free to everybody because what we try to do is we try to communicate to everybody what SMPTE is doing in the area of standards development. Today's guest speaker is Mr. Jim Whittlesey. Jim is the CTO of Icon Group. And Jim, I have unmuted you. I'm going to mute myself in a moment and then give you control. So when you're ready, please go ahead and take it over.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Joel. And thank you, everybody, for turning out for this during the summer holiday period. I see through the list, I see a lot of old friends out there. So this will be fun. So jumping right into the presentation. All right, so this is our agenda. I always start off these presentations with reviewing some of the important acronyms. You know, DCI's or Digital Cinema has its share of acronyms. I'll talk about some of the file name changes, some of the simple ways to detect whether you have a SMPTE-DCP or a Interop DCP. Talk about some of the differences between in the CPL file, the packing list, the asset. We'll also talk about the changes to the image track file, and then more importantly, all the changes that went into the subtitles. There's quite a bit of changes in the subtitles, and then the audio track files, there's quite a bit of additional capabilities in the SMPTE, packages, namely audio labeling. So with that, we'll jump into the acronyms. Okay, I trust everybody knows what a DCP is, but it's a set of files consisting of an asset map, volume index, packing list, one or more composition playlists, one or more image track files, one or more audio track files, and possibly some subtitle track files. For Interop, those would be XMLs. For SMPTE, the XMLs are wrapped into a MXF track file, which I'll go into detail later. Composition playlist defines how movies play, define which order the tracks or files are played out, reels, defines which portions of a track file is played. A friend of mine went the other day told me it's the timeline of your movie, and I always thought that's an interesting way to look at the composition playlist, is it defines the timeline of your movie. And then MXF, that was a standard generated by SMPTE many years ago for encapsulating audio-visual. It's mainly done for the broadcast industry, but Digital Cinema uses it extensively. And last, the packing list. And this is just a list of all the elements within a DCP. It defines the type of files. It defines the size. It has a message digest, so it allows you to determine if the assets were received without errors. You can have multiple packing lists per DCP. Okay, this is kind of one of me getting a little bit onto a soapbox, but the differences between DCP and CPLs, often they're used interchangeably, and I just kind of want to reinforce that one delivers or distributes a digital cinema package, right? You play a composition. You do not distribute a composition. You do not play a DCP. Just kind of want to make sure everybody understands that distinction, and I will get off my soapbox now. Okay, a little bit of history. How did we get to where we're at? You know, the Society of Motion Picture Television Engineers, SMPTE, took on the responsibility for writing and developing and approving all the digital cinema standards. this work started way back in 2000 when at the Universal Hilton, I think, if my memory serves me correct. And we started off with 7 study groups. And that went for a couple of years, and those turned into working groups for developing specifications and standards. DCI completed their specification August 2005, and the digital cinema rollout started in the spring of 2006. Cinedigm had got their first set of VPFs and had installed about 15 screens, and I think the first movie that went out was something called Aquamarine from Fox. But the problem was that the SMPTE standards weren't complete in 2006. So what the industry decided to do was take a snapshot of the existing standards, called it Interop, and away we went, rolling out digital cinema across the world. In 2009, SMPTE finished the basic digital cinema standards, and now we're trying to migrate the industry to a truly compliant SMPTE package. This is a list of all the SMPTE standards that have been developed for digital cinema or related to digital cinema. This, coupled with the DCI spec and the compliance test plan, represents a huge volume of work, very thorough, very detailed. If you're at all involved in digital cinema, I highly recommend that you purchase the standards from SMPTE. They're very worthwhile. The DCI spec and the compliance test plan you can get from the DCI website. Okay, the first change that's fairly simple to spot between an Interop and a SMPTE package is the asset map and volume index. Interop packages, they did not have a file extension. They were just labeled asset map volume index. In a SMPTE package, they have the file extension. They're required to have the file extension .xml on there, and you can see that in the slide. Just for knowledge base, the volume index is no longer used. It is always set to one volume. And this file is simply a placeholder so that, you know, systems out there don't break. You know, disk drives have gotten so big that we really don't have a problem with getting all the DCPs on one hard drive. So the volume index has outlived its usefulness. So here I'm showing you a Interop DCP package, and if I flip to the SMPTE, you'll see that the .xmls are on the asset map and volume index, going back and forth here. Okay, and just for the asset map, volume index, and packing list are represented in red. Those files with the others represents the DCP. The file names in gray represent a CPL. Or composition. Okay, some other changes that are simple to identify whether you're SMPTE or Interop. Within the XML files, you'll see that the namespace has changed. In the Interop, it was www.digicity.com. In a SMPTE, it's www.smpte.ra.org. So this is a CPL. You can easily see the namespace has changed. You can also go down to the bottom of the representatives of the XML, and you'll see the content title text. And you'll notice in there that the content title text does identify that it's a SMPTE package. And in the Interop, it defines it as Interop IOP. You can't necessarily rely on the content title text as being correct, but it's also identified in there. And here we are in the packing list. You see the same name change, the namespace changes there, and in the asset map. Okay, image and audio track files. The image and audio track files are binary files. You can't easily read them or look at them, right? There is a small difference in how the binary data is organized between Interop and SMPTE MXF track files, and therefore the image and audio track files are not, I repeat, not interchangeable between Interop and SMPTE. So if you're converting from an Interop to a SMPTE package, you must rewrap your image and audio track files. You can't use them straight across. And it's not that big of a deal to unwrap it and rewrap it. There's lots of software tools that will do that for you. It's also important to note that if the essence data is encrypted, you must decrypt it and re-encrypt it with a new symmetrical key, both image and audio, when converting from Interop to SMPTE. Composition playlist. Okay, there's a few small changes to the composition. Well, this is basically what a composition playlist is, and we've sort of went through that earlier on, just repeating it, but it defines the orders and how the track files are played out, what portions. It can be used as a simple edit and decision list. All these functions still reside in SMPTE and Interop. The SMPTE CPLs have additional new metadata to help with the GUI interfaces and other areas. They also have markers. The markers, like first frame reaction, start of credits, and those were also part of Interop, but never really used and never really tested. There's an effort within the industry now to start taking advantage of this feature to help in automation at the theaters. So part of the SMPTE DCP testing process is to verify that the markers are working as defined. So be advised that you need to be able to put the markers in there, put them in the right spot, and they need to work. Okay, this is probably one of the biggest areas of changes between SMPTE and Interop package, right? In Interop, we have separate XML files that control the on-screen subtitles. These XML files were based on a standard called CineCanvas from Texas Instrument. In addition to the XML files, there's a TrueType font file to support time text subtitles. There are also PNG files to support PNG subtitles. All these files were kept in a separate folder, typically one per reel. And here's an example of what an Interop DCP with subtitles would look like. And you see on the left, we have our asset map, volume index, composition, packing list. We have five reels of image, five reels of audio. And then off on the right, we have a subtitle directory, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's for reels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And within that, you have the XML. And in this case, these are time text subtitles, so you have the aerial font file. It's important to note that aerial font file within those directories may not be the same. Sometimes they apply font compression to make those files a little bit different, so each of those TrueType fonts may be unique. Okay? SMPTE subtitles. SMPTE went off and took the CineCanvas spec, and they've turned it into a SMPTE subtitle specification 428-7. I think 2014 is the latest version. A lot of that work's being done by Jean Philippe at Dolby or Doremi now. He's doing an excellent job there, moving that standard forward. There's a TrueType font file to support time text, just like in Interop, and PNGs to support PNG subtitles, just like Interop. The big difference is all of those above files are wrapped into a subtitle MXF track file, much like image and audio essence. And the subtitle track file can be encrypted, same as image and audio. Also, the SMPTE standard for subtitles will support 3D or stereoscopic subtitles. This is mostly working, and we'll see. And then the other reason for putting this into an MXF track file and encrypting it was the subtitles represented the script of the movie, and there was those at the studios that were uncomfortable having the script of the movie in the human readable plain text, so they asked that we find a way to encrypt it. So that's where the driving force behind this is.
Hey, Jim.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. We have a question. Can you take it?
Sure.
It's from our guest Dino. Dino asks, are multiple reels necessary?
No. There have been a few DCPs that have gone out as a single real. Generally, you know, in the post-production environment, they still work in reels, much like in the film days, and it's a little easier moving around, you know, a 30 gigabyte reel than moving around a 150 gigabyte, you know, complete reel for the whole movie. But there's no reason why you can't do a movie in a single reel.
Makes sense. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions?
Not at this time.
Okay. So so basically, the SMPTE subtitles are wrapped up into a special MXF track file called the SMPTE subtitle track file. And now this is what the SMPTE DCP would look like. And on the left, we have the asset map volume index, the five reels of image, five reels of audio. On the right, we no longer have separate directories, but we have five separate MXF files that represent the subtitles for each of the reels. Okay? Okay, in audio, currently the standard allows for up to 16 channels of audio. Currently supported are sort of left, right, 5.1, 7.1, the Dolby Digital or Dolby or Disney 7.1 surround that's very popular. In addition to the audio channels carry other data. For example, the hearing impaired or the visually narrative channel. They also carry D-Box motion control, the sync signal for immersive audio that we'll talk about in a little bit. Okay, so the audio channel assignments for Interop, these channels are hardwired to an ISDCF agreement or standard. I'm not sure exactly what you call it. You can see the reference to that document there. All 130,000 plus digital cinema theaters in the world are all wired to that specification, and it makes interoperability real simple and real easy. And basically, there's a one-to-one correlation. Channel 1 in the MXF track file is routed to channel 1 of the server, with the understanding it is routed to the auditorium's left speaker. Channel 2 would be routed to the right, channel 3 would be center, channel 4 would be the subwoofers, and if you pull up the ISDCF document, you'll see the routing details in detail. So let's go on to the next slide. Okay, this is sort of the autonomy of a MXF track file, right? And here I've showed that the 16 channels of PCM audio are frame wrapped. So those 16 channels represents 1/24th of a second. I'm assuming that we're running at 24 frames a second and we're running 48 kilohertz sampling rate. So you see 1, 2, 3, 4. Those are the audio samples for channels 1 through 16. Each one holds 2,000 samples, okay? So in this case of Interop, channel 1 would be routed to left, channel 2 would be routed, or channel 1 would be routed to left, channel 2 to right, channel 3 to center, 4 to subwoofers, 5 is left surround, 6 is right surround, and so on according to the ISDCS spec. And so when people master it, they lay down these channels exactly according to the ISDCF. When people play it back, they play it back according to the ISDCF spec, and everything works perfectly. I see that there's a question about Atmos. I will be covering that on my last slide. So SMPTE audio. You know, in a SMPTE audio, there's a UL or universal label that sort of defines the audio configuration. So you can put in there, this is a 5.1 or this is 7.1 or it's something called MCA. But what we've really decided to sort of standardize initially in SMPTE audio or SMPTE packages with the audio is something called wild track format. And wild track format is basically the exact same channel audio mapping as Interop. And it makes things very easy to use initially. Now there's something called MCA, I should have put in the slides, but let me back up. This UL, where it says this is 5.1 or 7.1 or wild track format, it sort of implies the audio channel mapping within the track file. There's another UL that's called MCA, and it allows for explicit labels at the individual audio channels that can be explicitly routed to any channel in the server. And that's, I think, where some people in the industry would like to take us, but right now it's not working very well. So you're going to see some experiments coming forward to support what they call MCA routing. But right now we use WildTrack format, which is exactly the same as ISDCF. Wow, this is going quickly. Okay, the future, immersive audio. We've all heard about Dolby Atmos, and there's some other competing formats out there called MDA audio and RO. This is work in progress within SMPTE. This will include an additional MXF track file called the AUX data track file. And this file will carry the immersive audio data, right? It will require a change to the CPL to reference this additional AUX data track file. There will also be some changes to the KDM to support the key delivery. All that's pretty much done. It's this is kind of just being worked out between the various different stakeholders in SMPTE as to where this goes. We'll just have to sit back and wait and see what comes out of the standard. But to give an example, the Dolby Atmos, right? You start with a SMPTE standard DCP, and then you add in all the extra information for the Atmos, which is an additional track file, and some changes in the CPL to reference that track file. And so that's kind of where it's going. Okay. So that's basically the differences between SMPTE and Interop. The big differences in the subtitles. They're wrapped in its own MXF file structure. The SMPTE allows for rendering of 3D subtitles. A lot of the people in the studios are really interested in being able to render 3D subtitles and get away from burned-in subtitles. There's the audio and there's the audio changes to support different audio configurations and to support an explicit audio routing mechanism. There's some changes to the CPL schema. Asset volume index must have their file extensions. And in the future, the near future, I hope, SMPTE DCPs will support a immersive audio standard. Okay. Test content. I've often asked where you can get test content. ISDCF, if you go to the website, they have a number of test DCPs. If you're a manufacturer of digital cinema equipment, and you've been through the compliance test plan, then there's a lot of SMPTE DCP tests that you can get from the CPT. SMPTE offers the Digital Cinema Leader. It's mastered it as DCPs in the SMPTE format. It's good test material. I didn't have time to check, but I think the ISDCF is also supplying some test content. You can check at their website. And some sources of information. This is where you would find the Interop documents that can be downloaded from here. SMPTE info is SMPTE.org. The ISDCF is a real good source of information. European Digital Cinema Forum, also a great source of I didn't get their website on there, but you guys can search it. And then there's also DCI. That's it, folks. I guess we finished a little early. So any questions?
We do have a couple of questions, Jim. Let's see, but before I ask them, I will invite our guests to cue their questions using the chat or the question box, however it's labeled on your control panel. And if you are adventurous, and I hope you are, please say, I'd like to ask a verbal question. That adds a unique dynamic, and you can actually have a discussion and conversation with our speaker. Let's see. We have a couple of questions in the queue already. One is from Adrian. He says, MXF subtitle track on MXF is SMPTE 436M or other track?
I'm not intimately familiar with all the SMPTE standards. I wish I knew the better side. Maybe somebody else out there knows.
Okay, and we can always follow up as well.
Yeah, we can follow up with that one.
Let's see. Any possibility, this is from Daniel, any possibility of there ever being DCP with an anamorphic squeeze to preserve full native resolution of an anamorphic captured image?
That's a loaded question, right? Well, I think some of you might be familiar with Quentin Tarantino's next movie is going to be in some aspect ratio of 2:7 something to 1. The if you do an anamorphic squeeze, then you sort of need a lens to unsqueeze it, or you have to unsqueeze it digitally in the projector. So, you know, I'm not sure that's going to happen anytime soon, but we'll see. We'll see.
Okay. Anything you can say about D-Prove?
About what?
D-Prove?
I don't know what D-Prove is.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Then we will move on to the next question. Let's see. How closely are DCP and IMF CPLs evolving?
Well, the IMF has taken a lot of the concept from DCPs and expanded it to meet their needs. So conceptually, the IMF CPLs are very, very similar to a digital cinema CPL. What was the question again? I mean, how similar are they? Or
yes.
Yeah, they're very similar. They, you know, IMF has taken a lot of the good from DCPs and expanded it out for the needs of their marketplace. It's the IMF stuff's taken off like crazy. It's great work.
Next question comes from Andrew. Any standards development consideration at this point for 8K's 22-channel audio?
Hey, Andrew. I assume that 8K is the resolution of the image and 22 channels of audio. Don't see much on the audio side of things. With the immersive audio, they have sort of virtually unlimited channels, and they've sort of taken over the ability, the way that we'll expand audio into the theaters. So I don't see that the number of audio channels will grow in the standard. Plus, that's the hardware change out in the field that would be monumental to do. So, I know that there are some media blocks that are going to offer, you know, maybe 32 channels, but they're going to use it more for being able to do immersive audio in the media block. As far as the 8Ks, do I have it right that this is 8K in resolution, Andrew?
Yeah, I think he's referring to UHD, the 8K resolution.
I don't see any projectors coming out anytime soon that will support 8K. There are those in the industry that believe 4K is probably as good as you can ever need in a theater, but, you know, who knows what will happen in 5, 10 years.
Isn't that the truth? Let's see. Okay. And I do encourage folks to post their questions in the queue, and we do have a few more here. Let's see. This is from Paul. Paul asks, what is the expected or accepted way to make a mono audio to be compatible with the DCP audio schema?
That's a good question. A long time ago, we did a mono presentation in which they routed the mono audio first in the center channel, and then they also routed it into the both left and rights. I can't remember exactly which one they started on, but it's just a matter of routing it into the center. If you route it into the center, you have to add in, all the channels have to be in pairs, so if you route it in the center, you have to add in some muted audio for the subwoofer, or, you know, route your subwoofer information in the subwoofer. But yeah, I think it's either filling the center screen channel or both the right, left, and center screen channel with the mono information.
Thank you for that. Next question comes from Frederick. There's a lot of compatibility problems with position, in parentheses, in the x-axis of subtitles he's talking about. So it's often necessary to burn them. Will it be better with SMPTE-DCP?
I certainly hope so. I hear your pain with the subtitles not being positioned quite correctly. There's a move afoot to put test into the compliance test plan that will verify the accuracy of placements of subtitles. And I'm actually working on a subtitle test plan for 3D subtitles that basically gives the subtitles plus or minus 1 pixel. And if they're beyond that, then they're probably out of spec. But that's to be determined, and please don't quote me on that. But yes, there is a move to afoot to tighten up and get subtitles working better and more accurately and more deterministically.
Okay, next question comes from our friend Bernat. Bernat asks, would a SMPTE-DCP play in all servers? Do Series 1 servers play them?
In theory, there should be no reason why a Series 1, the old external servers can put, there's no reason why they can't play a SMPTE package, right? It's just a matter of getting the software upgraded. And I've actually tested SMPTE packages on old Doremes, old GDCs, old cubes, and they played fine. So, yeah, it's my understanding that all equipment can be upgraded to support SMPTE packages. Now, they may not be able to render 3D subtitles. The Series 1 projector cannot render 3D subtitles, never will be able to. But the Series 2s can render 3D subtitles, as can most, if not all, the media blocks.
Let's see. Next question comes from Walter. He asks, what are the technologies out there, and in parentheses, even open source, only to avoid publicity, to wrap SMPTE subtitles into MXF subtitle track file?
There's a lot of people that offer those softwares. There's a lot that's available out onto the web, right? I hate to name manufacturers because I'm sure I'll forget somebody and they'll feel offended. So, but yeah, there's just about everybody can do the SMPTE subtitles. As far as like the DVSs and the Doremi Dolbies and Colorfront. You know, Open DCP, the friends at Fraunhofer, Easy DCP, they can all do it.
Great. Let's see. Stefan asks, any news regarding higher frame rates? Hobbit went off outside the DCI standards, but worked out quite well. Now, will this be included in the standard soon?
The frame rates, as far as I know, are across Interop and SMPTE titles. I was afraid I was going to get a frame rate question. There's a lot of stuff going on with higher and higher frame rates. Even there's going to be a movie out next fall that's outside the standards for both DCI and SMPTE for frame rates. It was shot at 120 frames per eye, 4K. Good luck, fight, you know. So the frame rate issue is going to be moving forward, and we just have to be prepared.
Okay. Right? Actually, Stefan followed up. He said, sorry, wasn't about the frame rate, but the outside data rate beyond 250 megabit per second towards 430.
Yeah, there's a landmine. Yes, there's work afoot to expand the compression data rate right now. I believe that Hobbit, at least for domestic releases, was running around 450 megabits a second, and most of the servers or media blocks could handle that. But yes, there's testing within a number of different organizations. The Academy is looking at it. The DCI is looking at expanding that to something that's reasonable. It's a difficult problem to decide, because it takes a lot of focus groups of people looking at images and deciding whether they can see compression artifacts or not, and sort of finding out where is that sweet spot between what manufacturers can deliver and what our creatives are demanding in image quality. But it's a work in progress.
Stefan says thanks. Next question comes from our good friend Bill Beck. What, if any, limitations will SMPTE-DCPs put on the evolution of high dynamic range content?
Nothing right now. Yeah. Hi, Bill. How you doing? There's no limitations in the SMPTE or Interop right now. The high dynamic range is defined, you know, really by the DCDM file that's coming in. And if we have to go to a higher resolution than 12 bits per color, then that will be addressed in the appropriate areas. But, you know, that's sort of more of a compression issue. But currently, DC or the SMPTE specs could handle whatever dynamic range is reasonable.
And we're nearing the bottom of our question list, so if anybody has anything that they would like to ask our speaker, Jim Whittlesey, about the comparison between Interop and the SMPTE DCPs, please add your questions. And we've not had any verbal questions, so looking for someone to step up and ask a verbal question. Let's see, our next one is from Shailendra. The question is, is there a move to standardize Dolby Vision metadata in DCPs?
That's a touchy question, but I believe that there might be how to say this without getting into too much trouble, but Dolby may decide to open that up to the industry and standardize it so it can be used in digital cinema. I suspect that it'll probably be some subset of what Dolby is doing. But yes, there is a move afoot to be able to expand the dynamic range of images in sort of the next round of projectors that we have coming out. So it's on the radar for people to do. It's just not clear how it's going to get done right now.
Okay, next question's from Walter. Can you elaborate a bit more about original version and versioning file differences, if any, as well as 25 frame per second DCPs between Interop and SMPTE DCPs?
As far as the frame rates, at 25 frames per second, Interop and SMPTE both support that frame rate, so there should be a real issue there. What was the first part of the question again? Sorry.
Let's see. Comparison differences between original version and version file differences.
Files. Yeah. Okay. Version files are what I call, partial packages or something like that. That concept is supported across both SMPTE and Interop, and the idea is that. You send out your original version to a territory, and then you say, well, all I really want to do is change to the audio files to dubbed audio. Well, then you send out a CPL with just the new dubbed audio tracks and send it to a theater that already has the original version. So when it loads it in, the CPL would get the image track files from the OV that had been previously loaded and use the dubbed from the partial package or version of file, as they call it. So that concept is supported in both standards. Does that help?
I think it does. And let's see, question from Yoshido-san. Is there any possibility for vertical subtitles like the Japanese in SMPTE DCPs?
As far as I, well, gosh, that's a, I assume that the subtitle track file or the subtitle SMPTE standard supports vertical subtitles. I'd be kind of surprised if it didn't. I know CineCanvas does, and I've actually done a few movies that had vertical subtitles in them, and I'd like to think that the SMPTE does support vertical track files, but I'll have to do some checking on that to be sure.
Thank you very much. Let's see. I'm going to give you the option of whether or not to answer this next question. It comes. It comes from one of our guests here. He says, "Will Interop be obsolete soon?"
No. I think Interop's going to be with us for a good long time. And if you think about it, there's really no compelling reason for the server vendors to rip the Interop out of their product, right? Because it's sort of going to be, there's always going to be archived versions of DCPs that will be in Interop format, and people want to play them without converting them. So I don't see the server vendors necessarily removing that feature from their servers. I see the mastering houses moving away from providing that as a service and just providing SMPTE packaging only, you know, over the next few years. But, you know, it'd probably be something like 10 years before they start building SMPTE only servers or software in the servers.
CJ asks a related question.
It
says, I understand that there's no stated date for ending Interop distribution, but if things like markers become more usable and used, will that prompt people to take on SMPTE-compliant DCPs? Is there any other tool like this that won't be in Interop?
I can't think of any other thing. I mean, the markers are the one area where Exhibition is interested in getting SMPTE packages, right? Because that represents a benefit for them. The rest of the benefits from SMPTE package are more in line with the studios. And, you know, so it's a hard thing to get people to switch over to these new packages. The other big issue is making sure that all the servers out there are upgraded with software that will support SMPTE packages. I mean, so... Does that help, CJ?
We'll wait for a response. He says, perfect. Let's see. Next question, and I'm not saying this individual's name intentionally just because I will mispronounce it, and I don't want to offend this person. The question is, any benefit to SMPTE DCPs related to KDMs?
None that I can think of. Yeah, I can't think of anything else. I mean, right now we're pretty much, everybody's using sort of what we call SMPTE standard KDMs. And I think, I can't think of any clear advantage for the KDMs. All the features and stuff in the KDM is sort of supported in both packages.
Okay, great. That appears to be the end of our questions. I want to thank our guests for submitting them. Any final comments before we close for the day, Jim, or do you just want to go right to the close?
Well, I would encourage people to, you know, to theater owners to download some of the test content that's available from the different organizations and start working with your equipment to see that it's SMPTE compliant, because SMPTE packages will be coming, and it's better to make sure you can do it, you know, before the stuff shows up. You've already have confidence that your equipment's going to play it, and there's no like craziness going on at the 11th hour trying to get your equipment to play it. I'm always available for questions if anybody wants to shoot me an email or anything. So that's it.
Awesome. And it's always a pleasure, Jim. Thank you for putting this presentation together.
Joel, thank you for hosting it. It's been a pleasure working with you.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you to our guests. Hope to see you next time, either on a SMPTE monthly educational webcast or one of our other webcasts, including the SMPTE Standards Update webcast. Thank you, everybody. Take care. Safe travels. We'll talk to you soon.